Hello and good morning, everyone. Oh, wow. Are we excited for this morning and the time that we're going to spend together? We welcome every one of you. I'm LJ Von Dolan. I'm the program coordinator for the education of children and youth in foster care for the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction. My background is as a school social worker. I've spent over 3 decades in public education, and I am thrilled to be able to co-present this morning with my friend and colleague from DHHS. Jessica, you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. Good morning, everyone. I am Jessica Fresina, and I am the foster care coordinator with the Division of Social Services in North Carolina's Department of Health and Human Services. I just want to echo LJ's statements. Appreciate you all being here. We have a lot of attendees this morning, and we're really excited for you all to hear from ourselves and some of our county partners on their collaboration efforts. And so just a couple housekeeping items. As Jay mentioned, there is a handout. So these slides are in the handout for you, available for you to download. So please feel free to do that. And this webinar is also being recorded and you can be shared later for some of your colleagues that may not be able to attend today or if you need to look back. So we will share more information about that shortly.
So, folks, we got a packed agenda for the next couple of hours, and we're going to start off by just taking a look at foster care in North Carolina, some of the data that we have. Our focus is going to be on the Every Student Succeeds Act, which, of course, promotes the educational stability for students in foster care. We'll take a look at the rationale, the provisions, the responsibilities, both on local education agencies, the LEAs, and on the local departments of social services. We're super excited this morning to have three of our counties featured to discuss collaboration at the local level. We've got Franklin County, Rowan County, and Buncombe County, and they're going to be talking about their collaboration and how they got where they are. And what they're doing now, what they want to do in the future. And I think that's going to be a real highlight. Just want to say a special thanks to our panelists for joining us today and for providing your leadership in this endeavor. So for those of you who do work in our local education agencies, our LEAs, and our county DSSs, we have a brief survey here for you, and we would love for you to take out your phone and capture that QR code. Or Jessica, we're going to drop this link in the chat. If you're on your computer, want to complete it this way. This is just going to give us some baseline information about who's here today, what your roles are, how you perceive collaboration in your local context. And this is for, I'll give a shout out and a huge welcome. I know on this call we've got some folks from the U.S. Department of Education, from other national level organizations, from state level organizations, from DPI and from DHHS. I know Dr. Marie Petrie Martin from the Executive Director of CERV is on this call. So a huge thank you to all of you. If you are at the state or national level or in an allied organization, this survey is not for you. This is for our folks who are in the localities. And if you're at the national or state level and you want your own survey, let me know and I'll make one for you, okay? So thank you all for joining that QR code or that link and just giving us some real quick baseline data that will inform our work at the state level with Jessica and me going forward to best meet the needs in the counties. I think we've had enough time for folks to capture that code or the link. The link will continue to be in the chat for your reference later.
All right, thanks, LJ. And this is probably familiar for most of you, but we just wanted to include this in case it's helpful. The definition of foster care from the Fostering Connections Act, which has some connections with ESSA, is that 24-hour substitute care for children that are placed away from their parents or guardians, from whom the Title 40 agency, which is in North Carolina, that is our local child welfare agencies, has placement and care responsibility. And so again, most of you probably know, but children in foster care can be placed in a number of different situations, whether that's in a foster family home, they may be placed with a relative, a group home, maybe a group home that is a therapeutic type setting, pre-adoptive home, and residential facilities.
Let's take a look at some of our data, and this is from the 22-23 school year. We had over 10,000 children in foster care in the state, and from what the local education agencies, the LEAs, reported, they reported 5,800 and some change, just under 5,900 students in foster care. The national projection of the number of children in foster care who are school aged for North Carolina would be 6,320. So all of those, looking at all those numbers, the projected number of students that we did not identify in our schools who are in foster care is 433. So obviously, if we're not identifying the students in the schools, then we don't know if we're serving them or how we're serving them. There's no way for us to know, are we affording them their educational rights as prescribed by federal law? So these school buses, y'all, represent the number of students who were not identified. I want each of you to envision each of these six school buses filled with 72 students. That's three to a seat, and we're talking these, that's for our smaller students, right? But 72 students in each of these buses that we didn't identify. And so I just challenge any of us, obviously, if we were missing one school bus of any given set of children in our state, we'd go looking high and low for them. And that's what I'm interested in all of us collectively doing going forward, is looking for these students, making sure that we're identifying them and on the same page with what their needs are. You see in that bottom little quadrant there that our LEAs reported about 21.6 students in foster care have IEPs, that's individualized education plans, meaning they qualify for special education services. So we identified 21.6% of our students in foster care having IEPs. The national projection is between 30 to 50% of students in foster care who also have IEPs. So we know that we're low there too. And so that compounds, obviously, our interest and urgency to appropriately identify these students, because we already know that based on having IEPs and being in foster care, those present special needs that that we want to be able to address in the schools. So let's take a look here at the educational outcomes for our students in foster care. And this is data from the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction, or DPI. We graduate roughly one in two students in foster care, 53.4%. So, and unfortunately, while this number is staggering, unfortunately, it is pretty much in line at the national level. I see this as an incredible opportunity for growth in our state. We together, collaborating together, we can make an impact here. We can make a difference here. We can take that data point and improve it, because every one of us knows what the trajectory is of someone who doesn't complete high school, and then compound that with someone who has been in foster care and then doesn't graduate from high school. The national research tells us what the implications of that are on a person's life. And I don't want to sound Pollyannic here. I mean it. What an opportunity for us together to work and improve that data point, get our students across that stage with a diploma.
All right. So I want to talk a little bit about the link between education, stability, and permanency. And for our child welfare folks, we're all really familiar with the fact that child welfare agencies are responsible for the safety, well-being, and permanency of children and youth that experience foster care. And all of those things really intertwine, and under well-being is the educational needs of children and youth in foster care. And educational well-being is absolutely linked to permanency. There's some research that backs that up, that children who remain in foster care longer are less likely to be reunified or adopted or reach permanency. They're more likely to struggle in school and have different special education needs. Whereas children who have achieved permanency do show higher rates of educational stability, whether that's school attendance, talking with caregivers about their schoolwork, less frequent school moves, and fewer suspensions. And so we talk about this because our collaboration efforts between all of our entities, child welfare cannot do this work alone. It's really important that there is a really high level of collaboration between all of the key partners and stakeholders to really support educational stability, as that really impacts both safety and permanency. So hopefully you all know, and if you don't, that is okay. The what we're here to share about today is ESSA, Every Student Succeeds Act. And this is a federal law that was enacted in 2015 and reauthorizes and amends the ESEA, Elementary and Secondary Education Act of 1965. But ESSA actually includes these foster care provisions that complement requirements of the Fostering Connections Act. And these provisions are specific to addressing the educational needs of students in foster care. And the Fostering Connections Act requires child welfare agencies to include assurances in each of the child's children and youth that they work with, their case plan, that they will remain in their same school unless a school change is in the child's best interest. So we just talked a little bit about what ESSA and Fostering Connections are. Again, these federal laws, and together these laws envision a dual agency responsibility. Again, that collaboration between state and local education and child welfare agencies to jointly ensure that school stability is addressed and that there is prompt school enrollment. So these are just a few key components of the ESSA law. Again, the goals are to increase the educational stability of children and youth experiencing foster care, removing any enrollment barriers, whether they move into a new foster home or they are placed back into their parents' home, or if they are adopted, really looking at removing any barriers to enrolling to any new schools, or helping stay in their school of origin, ensuring that these children receive high quality educational opportunities that their peers also receive, and really closing any achievement gaps. LJ shared some data in the previous few slides about some of the achievement gaps that our children and youth in foster care are more likely to experience. And so ESSA works to really address that and improve the educational outcomes for children and youth in foster care.
So we're talking about who are the key stakeholders here. And this graphic is intentional, folks, with the student in the middle. I have learned in all of my experience that anytime we keep the student in the middle of the conversation, kids win, students succeed. when the adults around them keep the focus on the student. And so surrounding that student, of course, is the Child Welfare Agency, the CWA, which of course here in North Carolina is DSS. CWA is the terminology used in the federal law, because not every state calls DSS DSS. We have the LEAs, we've got guardian ad litems, who are often a big part of the picture in a student's life. We have parents and foster parents, and then that category of others can go on and on. That might be an interested neighbor with a vested interest. It could be someone from a faith-based organization or community organization. Those others could go on and on. Others could be mental health providers, the courts, Department of Juvenile Justice. So within each of those, within many of those circles there surrounding the student, there are various layers, and we'll see that demonstrated later in our, when our panelists speak to folks in schools. I want to draw your attention to this. There's so often that when a student is taken into foster care, we are reticent, hesitant to speak with the parent because we're not sure, does that parent still have rights? And we stop speaking with that parent a lot of times because we're scared. We don't know and we don't want to mess anything up, right? But more times than not, parents maintain their rights. Parents still are able to make educational decisions for their child. And so that in the collaborative piece between schools and DSS is something that we need to ask questions about, get clarity on. To what extent is this parent still able to be involved? Are there safety concerns where they can't be involved? But I want for school folks to realize and remember that the parent's still a critical piece of this circle of support. So some of the key terms here, we've already used several of them trying to get people acclimated. There are many acronyms within each of our entities, right, within child welfare and within school districts. One thing I'd encourage each of us to do in our collaborative efforts is to ask questions. We throw around terms because, you know, in school world, we use these terms all the time and we just forget that maybe someone from DSS doesn't know what that means. And the reverse is also true. DSS, you have your own lingo that sometimes we in the schools don't fully understand. And so I just want to encourage folks to ask those questions when we hear acronyms that we just really maybe think we should know, but we don't. So we've already used LEA, meaning Local Education Agency, and that in more lay terms is it just means school districts, or if you're in a charter school is your own LEA. Child Welfare Agency, School of Origin, we're going to be talking about a good bit here, and then best interest determination meetings, bid meetings, we will be talking about in depth as well. We'll be talking about immediate enrollment and then additional costs, which is a reference to transportation, which is something that that we all put our heads together to problem solve on. So our LEAs, it's important for everyone to know that every LEA in North Carolina has a foster care point of contact, a POC. So every school district out there and every charter school has someone who is identified to meet the educational needs or to ensure that the educational needs of students in foster care are met. If you don't know who that point of contact is for the school or school district that you need to contact, and here in just a bit, we'll be showing you exactly where you can find that information on a website. So generally, the point of contact is the person who is first in line when the DSS agency notifies an LEA that a child has gone into foster care or has experienced a placement change. That's not always the case, but generally that is how we set it up. I have been notified that sometimes there are DSS agencies that will notify a principal We really want to encourage everyone to notify that point of contact, because that point of contact is the central hub to ensure those educational rights are being met. So they're there to support the educational stability for our youth experiencing foster care. And they are play an important role in best interest determination meetings, the enrollment and transfer of records, transportation coordinating, training of other personnel within the school districts. So if and when there's any time that you're experiencing any difficulty with a child in care being enrolled in school, reach out to that point of contact. They're going to be the person who can best connect you and connect others to collaborate and with that circle of support around that child.
All right. The next key term is child welfare agency. And again, we talked about how child welfare agencies are responsible for the safety, permanency, and well-being needs, well-being including educational needs of children and youth that experience foster care. And so child welfare folks really do play an important role in the best interest determination meetings, which we will talk about shortly, as well as enrollment. Child welfare workers may enroll students themselves or work with a relative or kinship caregiver, foster parent, group home, wherever that child is placed, to make sure that they are enrolled and that any records are transferred. Again, also working towards coordinating transportation needs. We know that you all at the local level play a big role on both entities for transportation, which we'll talk about shortly. And again, just echoing what LJ just shared, you know, the child welfare agencies are really a vital partner to LEAs, just as LEAs are a vital partner to child welfare agencies. And we really do encourage each child welfare agency to designate a local ESSA point of contact. The school systems have a local point of contact. And so you'll hear some really great efforts from our county presenters later on. But having that local point of contact can really help boost some communication levels between both entities, and just sharing, even if it's not specific to a certain child, having a point of contact can speak with LEAs about different collaborative efforts or points of concern, things that you all can address at the local level, or maybe need to reach out to the state agencies to gather additional support for. So school of origin can mean one of two things: either the school where the child is enrolled prior to coming into foster care, or the school where the child is enrolled prior to a foster care placement change. And so the student should and can and should remain in the school of origin unless it is not in their best interest, which is determined at those bid meetings. But they can remain in that school of origin during the time that they are in foster care. And we also have federal and state guidance that really encourages schools to continue prioritizing educational stability when a student exits foster care in the middle of the school year, and prioritizing that stability for the remainder of the school year. So this may look like a student is adopted and they need to remain in a school of origin, even if it's not in the adoptive parent's school district for the remainder of the year, the school year. LJ, is there anything you might want to add to this slide?
No, I think you covered it great. Thank you.
All right. So best interest determination, or bid, I think a lot of us probably use that term, bid meetings. So again, you'll see on the right-hand side that there are factors that you take into consideration at your local bid meetings. Maybe the school preference of the student or parent or the placement provider, how long is it going to take them to commute, to a potential new school? What is the impact on the permanency or potential impacts on academic performance? And so DSS and LEA agencies should be coordinating to determine whether the child remains in the school of origin or needs to enroll in a different school. Do want to mention this text in red here, that transportation costs cannot and should not be a factor when determining best interest. That is absolutely just not an option for determination. And also just disputes. If any party to the bid meeting disagrees with the outcome, there can be an informal review by the DSS director, and that can be requested in writing within 3 days of the bid meeting. And during that time, the child would remain at the school of origin while any disputes are being resolved.
Now, just one more point on the bid meetings. I've had contacts with folks across the state who've said, oh, we don't do bid meetings. And I just see that as such a missed opportunity, never mind the fact that it is, you know, it is compelled to, we are compelled to conduct bid meetings from federal law. Bid meetings are such a wonderful opportunity for folks in schools to be able to know, what are the interests of the child? What are the strengths? If they are needing to enroll in a new school, how do we ease that transition? So sometimes we don't hold bid meetings because the student's going to be transferring 2 hours away and we know that there's going to be a school placement change. Those bid meetings are still critical opportunities for us to connect and collaborate and have the information that we need from the school side to best set that child up for success in that transition. So it's another way that, frankly, we can start improving those data points, if you will. But more than the data, when we stay focused on the child, the data falls in place, always, always. So I just want to encourage folks out there, if you're not doing bid meetings, I want you to see them as an opportunity. And I know a lot of folks are thinking, wow, I got so much to do, I don't need another opportunity. And I hear you on that too. But they are just such powerful ways for us to connect, know our students, and then be able to set them up for success. All right, that's the end of that on bid meetings. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk. Folks, with immediate enrollment, a child in foster care should be enrolled in school as soon as possible to prevent educational discontinuity. We are talking about immediate enrollment. And we understand that some of our students, if they're coming out of psychiatric residential treatment facilities, or if there have been big lapses in their educational careers, there can be factors in which it might take a bit for us to get together and make the best educational placement for that child. Okay, I've had folks call me and say, LJ, I want you to know it's going to take us maybe 2 days to get this together. That's not a problem if everybody's communicating and collaborating and we are focusing on the specialized needs of that child. So, but immediate enrollment is expected, and communication and collaboration to facilitate that enrollment as soon as possible is the it is the expectation, because it is what is in the best interest of any child, especially our children in foster care. So federal guidance tells us that enrollment cannot be delayed because a student doesn't have normally required documents. Okay, so that doesn't mean that we can't have a phone conversation and say, but this is what I know. Yeah, we don't have the IEP in our hands right now, but this is what we know about the learning needs of this child. I think I want to encourage us all to do that so that so that children are enrolled as soon as possible. And enrollment means more than just put in the Power School system or whatever student information system we're using. It means attending classes and participating fully in school activities. So let's talk about transportation, which obviously we know is a challenge, not just for us, not just for you all in your localities, but across the state and indeed across the nation. Transportation is a factor that requires us to collaborate to make sure that we're getting our children in school and to and from school. So federal law says that LEAs have to develop and implement clear written procedures on how transportation will be funded or arranged and provided for our students in foster care. That's federal law, that LEAs have to develop clear written procedures. Okay. Those procedures have to ensure that the students will receive that transportation in a cost-effective manner. And then the law goes into three examples, if you will, of how transportation can be funded, all right? The law says if the child welfare agency agrees to reimburse the LEA for transportation, we can do that. If the LEA agrees to pay the cost, we can do that. Or if the LEA and child welfare agency agree to share the cost, we can do that. So DSS can pay for it, the LEA can pay for it, or we can agree to share the cost. I've had folks ask me, well, does that mean 50-50 split? Does not mean 50-50 split. The law doesn't prescribe that. That is up to each locality to determine what's agreeable, and we'll talk about how we reach those conclusions here in just a moment. So for any child that we transport to and from school, there's a cost, of course. If and when we transport children outside of the local attendance zone, there's additional costs. So that's what we mean by additional costs. It's the cost to transport a child to and from their school of origin when it's outside of the attendance zone in which they're residing. And so the federal law says that LEAs have to address additional costs to provide that transportation. So LEAs are points of contact on this call. Any federal programs directors, possibly any transportation directors, we are compelled by federal law to figure out how are we going to provide the transportation and how are we going to fund it. So charter school folks, this is important for you all and any of you DSS folks who are working with students in foster care who attend charter schools. The law specifies that even if an LEA does not provide transportation, they are required to provide it for a child in foster care. Okay, I'll say that again. Even if they don't provide transportation for other children, they are compelled to provide transportation for children in foster care. All right, that second bullet is the long part of the law. And that third bullet is really important for all of us to know that funds that are reserved for students experiencing homelessness may not be used for students in foster care. Those are two separate funding streams that federal law actually separates. And so at the state level, local level, we have to ensure that we're not using funds that are dedicated for students who are experiencing homelessness, that we can't use those funds for our students in foster care. So on the website here, you see the link here. And Jessica, can we throw that link in the chat, please?
Absolutely.
There's a sample transportation agreement. So this is a sample. It can be used by LEAs across the state in conjunction with DSS. It can be edited and modified to meet your unique context. It can be edited and modified to cover your entire locality. It can be student specific. This is a sample that you can edit at will. This is just provided so that obviously, so you don't have to reinvent the wheel. We've given you an example of something, a document that will help you in the process. So that is on the North Carolina Foster Care Education Program website. It's a relatively new website that we've gotten up and running. Folks in LEAs, particularly our points of contact, you'll find lots of rich resources and information there. A little while ago, I referenced a point of contact directory. We'll speak to that again in a moment, but that directory is on this website as well for anyone to find out who is the point of contact in any particular school district or charter school. That's where you can find this. So our memorandums of understanding, you'll find a sample MOU on that same website that we just referenced. MOUs are critical at the local level, and a lot of y'all have them and some of you don't. And in your locality, if you do not have an MOU, it is highly, strongly encouraged. An MOU outlines what are the responsibilities of each entity. How are we going to communicate with each other when a child goes into care or has a change in placement? Let's talk about student confidentiality with regard to student records and the need to know information between LEAs and DSS. What are the data sharing procedures? So how do we communicate with regard to who are our students in care? What are their grades? What is the attendance? And some of you are working in localities where you've got 3 to 10 students in care. Others have over 500 students in care. And so your MOU is going to be designed for your unique context. Referencing back to the transportation plan and agreement, the memorandum of understanding will include that as well. What is that cost sharing agreement? So how do we divide those costs if that's something that's determined? What's the process for disputes if we don't agree with each other? And then a review date. And we encourage MOUs to be reviewed annually at a minimum. They can be reviewed at any time. You're going to hear some of our localities in a little bit talk about their process for reviewing their MOUs and the importance that the MOU plays in their counties.
All right. Just want to mention in the chat, it seems like the link for the website was not working. And so I popped the appropriate link in the chat. Just want to make sure you all see that. All right.
Thank you, Jessica.
So, yeah, no problem. So for our child welfare folks, we won't have time to go through all of these today. And again, just a reminder, these slides are provided as a handout with links in them. So I encourage you to take a look at these forms. If you are not familiar with them, take a look at what is in our policy manual. All of these forms are referenced in our permanency planning policy manual. And really talk with your local agency, your local child welfare agency, your supervisor or your program manager about these forms if you are not familiar with them. I do want to say that some counties, again, some county child welfare agencies have different processes, local processes for ESSA. And so there might be folks in your agency that are completing these forms for you at bid meetings or things like that. So again, just really want to emphasize for you to do some research about these forms. You are always welcome to reach out to me if you have any questions about any of these forms as well. And my contact information is at the end of these slides.
So I wish that somebody, and maybe someone has counted the number of times we've said collaboration today. It is one of my favorite words. And so let's talk about some of the formal structures in which there is collaboration between DSS and LEAs and the schools. And if you see one of these things, if we're talking about one of these things and you say, hey, we don't have that, we don't do that here, then we encourage you to pick up the phone and call your counterpart in the office building across town and have a conversation around that. I'll share with you, when I started my position just several months ago, I didn't know who counterpart was at DHHS at the state level. I didn't have a clue. I didn't know how to find it. I Googled DHHS, North Carolina, and I made a cold call to North Carolina DHHS. And I said, this is who I am. I don't know who I need to speak with or if this person even exists. And it wasn't a day later, and the person took my call, and wasn't a day later, and Jessica returned the call. And that's how we started our relationship at the state level. And I will say Jessica has been a pleasure ever since. That one phone call led us here. Now, Jessica wouldn't have necessarily known that I existed at all. I just started. And prior to me, there was a vacancy in the position. So she was, I'll speak for you, Jessica, happy to receive the call. And that level of collaboration is what has led us here today. So I just want to share that with you as a model, that sometimes it's just about picking up the phone call, not even knowing who it is you're wanting to get in contact with. So all of that said, at the local level, our collaboration starts with notification of eligibility. And I'm going to reference back to the data points that we discussed earlier with the fact that in the schools, we're not identifying all of our students in foster care. And sometimes that's because we've got our own, internally, we've got our own data tracking challenges that we're working on, right? We've got opportunities for improvement internally with LEAs. And sometimes, however, that's because LEAs are not being notified by DSS when a student is in care. And so we've got to start right there in that very first square with notification, making sure that at the local level, we know who's in care and what school they're going to. And then it goes on from there, of course, with the in the LEAs is figuring out, you know, what needs do they have within those, within the educational setting. So we've got our forms and documentation that then follow, and Jessica referenced those DSS forms just a bit ago. We've got all of our meetings, right? The BID meetings, child family team meetings, educational services meetings, IEP meetings, the meetings go on and on. Every one of us that works in a bureaucracy knows that. We step into this world acknowledging that. Participation on with both entities is so critical in those meetings, because there are things that you know in DSS about children that we don't know in schools. There are things that you know that we don't need to know in schools, and we need to operate in our collaborative processes with that respect and understanding that that there are different facets that we don't need to know. We go back to student confidentiality and the sharing of information. Those of us who, and I bet you 90% of us on this call are social workers, whether you work in the schools or DSS, we're social workers, and we know the social work ethic and value of confidentiality, client confidentiality, and sharing need to know information. So we need to just open those lines of communication and not take that personally when we're told, well, we really can't share that detail with you. There's a formal and informal communication. So we've got the formal documentation and meetings, but I can tell you, and I know that several of you have experienced this as well, the times when there's I run into somebody in the hallway at school, they're there for to see another student, but I say, hey, can you step into my office for a minute? I want to fill you in about so-and-so. Is there anything that you can share with me, because this is happening and we just blah, 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 right? Want to work that out. So those informal lines of communication are paramount. When there's informal communication, most times that's an indication that trust and relationship have been built. Okay. We've got our formal agreements of memorandums of understanding and transportation plans, which we've talked about, the data sharing that is encompassing in those plans, regularly scheduled collaborative meetings. Where our students experience success is where we've got both entities that are collaborating regularly. They have set aside the time and the personnel to talk about what we need to ensure the educational stability and enhance the educational outcomes of our children in care. And then when there are joint trainings going on, that more times than not is I have seen as the public declaration that we are on the same page, we are working together here, things are not seamless. It is all a process. It will always all be a process, always. There's not ever a time where we hit the end of the road here. There are always opportunities for growth and enhanced communication, but those joint trainings that are happening out there, much like what you're seeing today, is an indication that, hey, we want to work on this together. If I haven't said collaboration 100 times yet, then let me say it again. Collaboration. All right, y'all.
I just want to mention, because you brought it up, and somebody brought up a really good question. A DSS worker asked about the 5760 verification of custody letter form. That form is absolutely needed. And if you're not familiar with that, I will drop a link to it in the chat. But when LJ was talking about sharing information, the verification of custody letter basically is allowing the child welfare agency or the placement provider to show, yes, this child is in the custody of a certain county DSS. And it references in that letter that DSS cannot share court orders. We know that sometimes different entities are asking for court orders to verify that that child is in DSS custody, and those court orders often have information that just is not needed to share and is not allowed to be shared by law. So just wanted to reference that and appreciate the person that brought that up, that form is absolutely needed and is supposed to be shared within 24 hours to a new school. Thank you.
Jessica, appreciate that question. Appreciate you addressing that. So I've referenced this a couple of times. This is just a snapshot of the website, the link below. Jessica shared that, the link to the website earlier. This is where all of our local points of contact are listed in a directory. There are 331 LEAs in the state, because we've got all of the charter schools, virtual schools, lab schools, all of those schools are included as well. So anyone, and our local points of contact use this form too, because there are times when they need to reach out to another point of contact in a different locality to discuss the needs of a student or transfer records, things of that nature. So encourage any and all of you to check out this website. There are a lot of resources on there. The law is linked here. There's an FAQ. This is where This recording will be housed and posted. So if there's anything that, any information that you want or need to know about the education of our students in foster care, this is a great reference point for you. I encourage you to visit it.
All right, thank you. Just once again, a reminder, if you are with a local county or LEA agency and you have not completed the survey that we spoke about in the beginning, I have dropped a link in the chat again. So you have heard enough from LJ and I for now, and we are really excited to have Franklin, Roanne, and Buncombe County partners to here to share about their local collaborative efforts. We really want to just thank all of these presenters because the work that you all do is at the ground level, and so we just want to thank you all for your efforts. So we are going to start with Franklin County, and I will toss it back to LJ.
Hello, Franklin County. Thank you guys for being willing to share your process and provide leadership across the state. And I just want to say thank you on the front end. Franklin County, Lena, I'm going to open it to you, and you want to introduce yourself and have your colleagues introduce yourselves, and then we'll go through your slides.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much. My name is Lena Robertson, and I do serve as the point of contact for Franklin County Schools. That's just one of the many hats that I wear, as we all wear multiple hats, I'm sure, in the roles that we serve and for students. Not only am I the foster care point of contact, but I'm also the McKinney-Vento liaison and our hospital homebound coordinator for the school system. So I get the opportunity to work closely with Ms. Richardson and Ms. Ward, and I'm happy that they're here with me today to share a little bit about what we're doing in Franklin County. Ms. Ward and Ms. Richardson, you guys want to say good morning?
Good morning. My name is Latasha Ward. I am one of the permanency planning supervisors here at Franklin County DSS.
Good morning. I'm Jay Richardson, and I am one of the other permanency planning supervisors here at Franklin County DSS.
Thanks, y'all. Thank you. Lena, Jeanette, Latasha, who would like to discuss your numbers?
So I tend to be the one that talks the most in our group. I just like to talk, so you can tell me that if I need to veer a different direction here, LJ, but you guys can see these numbers here for our small rural county. Just a little bit about the demographics of Franklin County. And we are in the central part of the state, just north of Wake County. Geographically, our county is fairly large, serving from one end to the other is a good 45-minute drive through the rolling hills and over a couple bridges. It's a good little drive, but we have a nice center spot of Lewisburg where our DSS is housed. And we do serve our surrounding counties in partnership with supporting students from other districts coming to our schools. And then unfortunately, sometimes our kids go to other districts as well. We do have 51 students currently in care for our DSS. Only 7 of those students are in our Franklin County schools, which is a fairly small number. Having looked at some of the other numbers for counties that we'll be sharing with you guys, I think you'll find that our numbers are small, and we are on the startup of learning how to support each other in partnership as well as our students in foster care. Our school system currently has 16 schools. We have a total of just over 8,000 school students enrolled in our schools and 22 total students in foster care. As I said earlier, 7 of those are from our local DSS and from within the school of origin, county of origin, and 15 are from other counties, having been placed in our system. So being new in my role with Franklin County, just like LJ mentioned about her position, I also stepped into my position fairly recently within this school year. I knew that there was a lot of things that I wanted to accomplish. And one of those was serving our students in foster care through my point of contact role. So I reached out to DSS and said, hey, we got to start somewhere. What can we do? So we did start to develop a relationship. And I'd love for Ms. Richardson and Ms. Ward to kind of talk about what we started with, what we're doing now, and maybe what we want to look at doing in the future.
So one of the first things after Lena reached out, which we greatly appreciated, is that we started doing just virtual meetings to review our current list of students enrolled in custody of DSS in Franklin County Schools. That includes both Jeanette and Ms. Richardson and myself, as well as Ms. Robertson. We use that day as a standing day on our calendar. So each month at the same time, every month, we check in to update on the number of kids that have come into custody or changes in any placements, children that have been unenrolled in Franklin County Schools and into another school system or vice versa. We share needs with foster parents and DSS social workers and just the supports that the school system has in place for our foster care children. Lena has been absolutely great in being a support and a point of contact for our county. There's not anything that we don't need in regards to our children. Even when they're placed outside of the county, some children have been placed outside of the county for several months, even some years, but you know, are still there. Franklin County is still the home county. And so when we're having a difficult time reaching other points of contact in other school systems, we can reach out to Lena and she is very helpful in picking up the phone and getting in contact with navigating that process of who our next point of contact needs to be in order to ensure that children are being enrolled timely, be it meetings are taking place, et cetera. So that's been very helpful.
One of the things we did at the school level, because I'm not based in a school as the point of contact, I had designated each of our school counselors at our schools as our school points of contact. So if there are needs or a child is placed and I'm not notified, our counselors have been given a Google form that they complete that notifies me of a placement, and then I can do some follow-up. It doesn't happen with my Franklin County folks, but if they're coming from outside of Franklin County, I think that's an area of growth that we're looking to continue to improve on, is when those districts from outside of Franklin County place students here with us, that we have those processes in place and follow up with bid meetings and placement meetings. So our counselors can complete that Google form notifying me of a placement, and then we work in partnership with other districts to make sure the needs of those students are identified and we're supporting them throughout their time in our school system. That's us in a nutshell. We definitely are learning and growing. As I said earlier, we're a smaller district, but this is one step in moving towards a bigger picture. And I've just really enjoyed the opportunity to keep the student at the center of our focus and identifying the needs that our foster care students have.
Great, thank you so much. And I really appreciate that you guys acknowledge kind of where you've started recently. It's never too late to start these collaborative efforts. If you are not doing that currently, you know, LJ mentioned that we hear that there are some counties that are just saying they're not doing bids. And so, now's a good time to start, right? They're required by law, but most importantly, they're student focused and they're just very vital for educational stability. And I just wondered if you could share a little bit more about your MOU and how has this been helpful thus far with any data sharing or transportation agreements, facilitating bid meetings?
Yes. We're going to review our MOU at the end of the school year. That will give each part an opportunity to assess what's worked for us, what changes are needed in the next school year. So I think that, you know, our partnership is definitely it's a true partnership. We thoroughly enjoy working with Lena, and I will say also, you know, with the virtual check-ins, even prior to virtual check-ins, if we know that a child is, we're immediately assuming custody of a child, I just tried to reach out to Lena just to let her know that we will be scheduling a VID meeting. So we definitely appreciate the partnership here at Franklin County.
Latasha or Jeanette, could you speak to your historical, because I don't recall how long y'all have been in your respective positions, but it's been longer than Lena has been in hers. I'm just curious about your historical collaboration with the LEA. I'm also interested to hear from you all how your superiors in Franklin DSS view collaboration between DSS and the schools.
I'll start a little bit and then I'll pass it on to Ms. Richardson, because I am kind of fairly new to Franklin County. I've been here for almost 2.5 years now in this role. But I do know that we have a fairly new director who was also the deputy director prior to taking on the new position. But since I've been here, and I think for the history of Franklin County DSS, once I joined this agency, collaboration and partnership with community providers and stakeholders has been a number one priority for our department. So we've always considered that a very high priority in maintaining positive relationships, collaborations with community partners and stakeholders. So reaching out to the school system, making sure that the MOUs were done timely, reviewed, you know, we collaborated together, sending them back, getting them signed off timely. That's just some of the history and some of the work, diligent work that Franklin County has always done and stood for.
And I will say, I've been here for about 26 years now. I started in permanency planning in 1999, but as a leader here at Franklin County, in the past, we have we've communicated with our LEA POC via like telephone call or maybe sending an email, but I really appreciate the monthly check-ins that we're doing now. So it definitely works for us in our county. So just having that on our schedule every month to know that we're gonna talk, and if there's any issues that come up, you know, Lena is available to help us through that.
Thank you. And have y'all, what's on deck for how you've mentioned that you're pretty new in the process with Lena as your point of contact, but what's on deck for future planning, for future collaborative efforts? Specifically, I'm thinking about, has there been any cross training or DSS collaborating with Lena to provide training to folks in the LEA or vice versa?
Yeah, I definitely think there are opportunities for us to include our data managers in some educational training, those frontline contacts, working with our counselors, as I mentioned earlier, who are our school points of contacts, and our school social workers, to partner with anyone at DSS, really, you know, knowing who our contacts are, knowing who to pick up the phone to try to reach or try to get in touch with. Again, collaboration, there's that word again, LJ. Collaboration and communication really are the focus for us moving forward into the next school year. And that will start at the end of this year when we get together to review data, to review what's worked and what hasn't worked, and how we can plan for moving forward. Not just operating in our own silos, but taking into the input from others, the workers, the direct staff at DSS, our counselors, our direct staff at schools, to see what they need from us, both as a point of contact and DSS, and what we can share with them to make their jobs easier as they support their students.
Any final words from our friends in Franklin County?
None from me. I'm just very appreciative of the collaboration and partnership that we have with Franklin County Schools, and specifically Lena as our LEA. So Much appreciated. Looking forward to all the good work that we'll do together.
And I'm looking forward to learning from my colleagues across the state. There's always room for growth, and when you start somewhere, you take that next step. So I'm looking forward to hear what other folks across the state are doing in their partnerships so that we can add on to what we've already got started here.
Thank you all so much. You're a small county, you're a rural county, and there are lots of small rural counties across our state. And some of them are have similar processes, and some of them heard you today and picked up on some tips and some endeavors that that they'll now initiate, you know, because of your leadership and sharing this morning. So thank you very much. Jessica, I'm going to turn it back over to you.
Yes, thank you again, Franklin County. All right, so next I will turn it over to our folks with Rowan County. We have Tamika Brown and Carla Johnston.
Good morning. I am Carla Johnston, and I am a permanency planning supervisor with Rowan County Department of Social Services.
And I'm Tamika Brown. I am the point of contact for Rowan Salisbury Schools here in Rowan County.
So just some of our data points for Rowan County Department of Social Services. We had about 174 youth in care in Rowan County DSS custody in early February, with about 103 of those students that are school aged. And those do include some of our youth that are 18 to 21 that do remain in a school high school setting.
And then in regards to our Rowan County school system data, we have a total of 33 schools in our district, and our total population is 17,769 students. The total number of students in foster care is 57. And that's within Rowan County. That does not include those students who are placed outside of our county or who are attending school outside of our county. So something that I am so proud to say that we are doing is we're having quarterly meetings. And those quarterly meetings include all of the designees within the schools. That could be school social workers or school counselors. And with those quarterly meetings, we have met at DSS several times. And not even to discuss bid meetings, but just to explain the roles. Because as you all know, in our roles, in our positions, there are turnover a lot on both sides, like on the school level and on the DSS level. There's a lot of turnover. So it's important that we have these quarterly meetings to explain the roles of what our school social workers do and what our social workers with DSS do. And it's always great to make those connections because what I'm finding is that I'm not receiving phone calls as the point of contact from my school designees to reach out to Ms. Johnson at RSS to reach out to her DSS worker. The school designees have that relationship with those social workers themselves. And so they make those contacts. And when we have those bid meetings, it is super, super important that those designees are on along with a representative from the school of origin and the school of residence.
We have also established trainings to keep each other aware of exactly what it is that we do. That includes having trainings yearly to discuss the bid meeting process. We also do trainings for trauma trainings, in addition to trainings for just regular CPS reporting and what that looks like. We provide that to Rowan Salisbury Schools. So we make sure that we are training each other's staff on what it is that we both do at our respective agencies.
The key words for us are connections and collaboration, because that's what makes our relationships grow. That makes it better for being able to provide for the needs of the students who are in foster care that we are serving in Rowan Salisbury Schools. So even when we have a bid meeting, you know, sometimes there may be a question about whether or not we should have a bid meeting. DSS does not have a problem with me even calling to say, hey, I think we need to have a bid meeting for this student. That's just the type of relationship we have. There are no judgments there that we didn't have one. It's just we need to have one. So let's move forward. Let's not focus on the fact that we didn't or that the social worker didn't call, or even because it falls back on all of us. It's our responsibility. We want our relationship to grow. So we want to make sure that we're focusing on our students are in the center of it, and we want each party to know that that's what we're here for. It's all about our students. So in order to do that, if I have to be proactive and say, let's have it, or if my designee says, oh, we have a student that has enrolled that's in foster care, then I'm reaching out to the DSS worker, and then the DSS worker may say, I was getting ready to contact you. Well, I contacted you first, so we're gonna have this meeting. And like I said, there are no judgments there. No one gets upset about it. We just know we have to have those meetings to make those connections and to make sure that our students are being served appropriately.
With our quarterly meetings, we're also making sure that we are providing appropriate case management and collaboration to ensure that we're not duplicating services. We have a lot of children who are in our care who might have already started services, and we don't wanna be recreating the wheel that they're already on. We wanna make sure that we're continuing services that might have already been in place, that were put in place by the school social workers prior to them coming into care. We have to do that by maintaining open communication. Mm-hmm. So that we are including everyone in the process, our meetings, and making sure that we are doing what is in the best interest for our children that are in care. Making sure we're wrapping all services around the family in order to keep them intact and provide reunification, which is the ultimate goal.
Exactly. And we at Rowan Salisbury Schools appreciate Rowan County DSS for being inclusive, for including us in that conversation, because it's so important that we are at the table when it involves our students that we're serving every day, you know, for 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. It's really, really key. One thing that I really enjoy being able to do is to be able to have teachable moments with my designees, because as we mentioned earlier, we have those quarterly meetings and we talk about the different roles and responsibilities. Sometimes we expect people to do certain things that's not what they're supposed to do. And so it's really important that I have those conversations, and Ms. Johnson as well, with her social workers and with my designees on information like LJ mentioned before. Is that information that you need to know, or is it information that you want to know? So keeping all lines of confidentiality there and making sure that is something that's also at the forefront when working with our students and our families who are in custody of DSS. We do have yearly reviews of our MOUs, and that has gone extremely well. With our MOU, we partnership in regards to transportation, where Rowan County DSS pays 50%, Rowan Salisbury Schools pay 50%. Now, your county may not do that, your county may do that, but we've made that decision that was a decision that we've made together in regards to how we would fund the type of transportation. What I will say that the most challenging for me, and some of the point of contacts could probably relate, is finding a vendor. Sometimes when our students are placed just on the outskirts of Rowan Salisbury Schools within a different county, it's really difficult to find a vendor. But I'm thankful that Rowan County DSS has been helpful in trying to identify vendors to be able to transport those students to their school of origin when it's just maybe 5 or 10 minutes outside of Rowan Salisbury Schools. that pretty sums it up in a nutshell with our collaboration with Rowan Salisbury Schools and Rowan County Department of Social Services.
Thank you both. I really appreciate a lot of the just the points of just collaboration and how you guys are addressing specific pain points. I like that you made a decision on transportation costs and you're going through with that. And so that probably might minimize some pain points throughout the process. I wonder if there's any other challenges that you guys are facing in your county for promoting educational stability, and if so, if there's any strategies that you've used to address those challenges.
I would say, I guess another challenge that we've probably faced is when a child is wanting to remain in the school of origin, but maybe need an alternative setting. And so we have to get others at the table to go through that process. So when we talk about immediate enrollment is not as immediate as we would like it to be. And I think Ms. Johnson would probably attest to that. So if a child is in foster care and they need a different setting, maybe a virtual setting, then there's a process to that. And immediate enrollment doesn't look like what we would like for it to look like. So I think that can be a bit challenging for me and for Ms. Johnson, because we want to get that child in school as soon as possible.
Yeah, just appreciate that that's on your radar, right? We all have pain points in these processes, and it's great that it's on your radar and that you guys are working to address that.
Curious, Tamika and Carla, how did you all decide to trust each other? Was that a conscious decision? Was there conversation around that? Can you just talk to us about that?
So just a little bit about me. I was a foster care social worker for 10 years with Rowan County Department of Social Services. I was there for 10 years. So I've been on the other side of that for 13 years with Rowan Salisbury Schools. I think that has helped me because I understand their roles because I've been there and I've done that. And that helped me automatically. So I just reached out and I just was like, hey, I don't know what was done in the past before I became the point of contact, but I want to make this relationship better. I'm willing to come in and train about bid meetings. They're saying we have to have these meetings. And so I'm willing to come in and assist you all with whatever I can do so we can build those connections and make sure our students, make sure we're talking about what's in the best interest of our students. And even if we don't agree, you know, ultimately we know DSS has custody. They can make the decision on, you know, where they want the student to be. But when we have those conversations, even if we go into a bid meeting with our mindset on wanting a child to move or wanting a child to stay, once we talk about all that it entails, that, you know, all the things that we need to in regards to the student, sometimes that changes. And I've been in meetings where that has changed. And so I just knew the importance of being able to collaborate, because we work together, we serve these families, we serve the students together. And if I can help, you know, I'm not trying to hinder that. I don't think it's beneficial to hinder that when we're working together for what's in the best interest. Now, their best interest sometimes is different from our best interest, but that's okay, because we're able to sit down and say, okay, I see where DSS is coming from. And then they're able to say, I see where the school system is coming from. A family is not going to be thinking about education for a student when abuse is like at the forefront, mental health needs are at the forefront. So I think because I came in with that mindset, I think that's why they trusted me a little bit more. I don't know, Ms. Johnson, I'm talking a lot, so maybe you can chime in.
I will say that around the time that Tamika stepped into her role, we had a shifting at Rowan County DSS and some changes in our leadership that opened doors for opportunities to further collaborate with the school system. And I am very appreciative of that change because it has allowed for us to have, you know, more opportunities for collaboration and for us to, you know, form this partnership and continue to, you know, serve in the best interests of our youth that we serve, so.
But thank you both. Thank you, Carla and Tamiko, for that. You used the term, Tamiko, a little bit. What was the term you used? There's no shame, right? Or blame. And I can't remember which word you used exactly. When something didn't happen, we're going to make it happen and move on. I just want to highlight the power in that because we are all busy, busy people. And sometimes things don't happen in the ideal way that we'd all love for them to happen, right? But staying focused on that problem solving and that working through it together versus the pointing fingers, I can only imagine how powerful that is and allows you all to get the work done on behalf of the student, keeping that, going back to that graphic at the very beginning where the student is in the center. You're not pointing fingers. You're making sure that that student stays the focus. And too often, just in my experience, and I know there's over 300 people on this call and everyone's probably experienced it. When we do point fingers, we lose sight of that child. That is the center focus. And so I just wanted to highlight that again, that I heard you on that. I hope other people heard you on that. I think that's a beautiful thing. It speaks to trust and communication and understanding where your hearts are and that you're in it together. So thank you for that.
You're welcome. And I think it was important for me to just in my role for my designees, to be that model, because I've heard them say DSS, this, you know, things about DSS, and just to say that we are accountable. All of us should be accountable. These are our students, and it's not us versus them or us against them. We are working towards making sure that our students are provided the education that they are needed within our school districts and DSS. Their goal is to make sure that they have housing and that they make sure that they are in an environment, a safe and stable environment while they're in custody. So it's not us against them. So we may as well work together and I just promote that and I live by that. So even when I hear it on my end, because I'm sure Ms. Johnson hears it on her end too, then, you know, some things that I have to be that example and just remind them, hey, we're working together. So don't lose sight of that.
Thank you both. You both brought up some really great points. Just want to thank you both again for sharing your contact information. Again, these slides are in a handout if anybody would like to reach out to them about their local collaboration efforts in Rowan County, you are free to do so. Thank you again, Rowan County.
Hello, Buncombe County.
Good morning.
You're home for us this morning. Y'all, we've got representing Buncombe County, we've got Amber Cook and Lizzie Scheimer and from DSS. And Buncombe County, if you don't know, is Asheville and the surrounding area. And we've got two school systems within the county, and that's not including all the charter schools that we have as well. We've got Shannon Boyd, who's the point of contact for Buncombe County Schools, and we've got Jordan Mayhew, who is the point of contact for Asheville City Schools. And thank you all for being here, and I'm going to turn it over to you. Talk to us about Buncombe County and the great things that are happening.
Thanks, LJ. I appreciate it. So my name is Amber Cook, and I'm the Permanency Planning Program Manager in Buncombe County, and I'll let the rest of the team introduce themselves. Lizzie, I'll turn it over to you.
Good morning. I'm Lizzie Scheimer. I'm our Resource and Support Program Manager with the county, and I'll turn it over to Shannon and Jordan.
Hey, I'm Shannon Boyd. I'm the McKinney-Vento and Foster Care Coordinator for Buncombe County Schools.
And I'm Jordan Mayhew. I'm with Asheville City Schools doing the same thing, just on a smaller scale.
So just a quick overview, and this data was effective as of February 19th, and I checked this morning. So we currently have in Buncombe County 334 children in foster care, and you can look at our population by current age. So the bulk of those children that we have are school-age children. And I'll let Shannon and Jordan go over their data.
All right, so I'll go over Buncombe County schools. So we have 46 schools, including one virtual. We have 22,720 students enrolled and 70 students who are in Buncombe County that are enrolled in our school system in foster care. That doesn't count any outside of Buncombe County.
And then for Asheville City Schools, we have 9 schools and 1 alternative program. We have just over 4,000 students enrolled within those schools and 20 students in foster care.
So here's where we're going to talk about our collaboration in Buncombe County. And just to give a little bit of like historical perspective, we started many years ago. Shannon, I don't know if you remember the year we started. I was trying to think of it this morning, but I feel like it was, 2017, 2018. But we started a while back with our processes, and we have really grown through the years and made a lot of changes in our partnership and collaboration with one another. Previously, several years ago, we were having, as we were kind of initially developing our MOU, we were having pretty frequent check-ins, monthly check-ins, and going over everything that we needed to do. But as time has gone on, we have been able to kind of shift the frequency of our meetings with our established MOU. So we currently meet quarterly with all of our internal partners here at Buncombe County, as well as with Buncombe County Schools and Asheville City Schools. It includes our POCs, it includes school social workers, counselors, anyone who needs to have a voice on that call. Sometimes people rotate in and off if there are specific topics that we have, but we leave it pretty open to those who can attend with our core group as well. We do have an established MOU, which we now update annually. I think our annual update started about 2 years ago. And one of the things I just want to hit on in this section, I heard LJ ask around like, how did we learn to trust each other and build our collaboration with one another? And I think it's through like lessons learned and through some really tough conversations. Initially, we started out with hiccups. We had challenges that we faced with one another. But one thing that we were able to really go back to along the way was our MOU. So there's a section in there on the MOU related to disputes. I'm not a big fan of that word, but that's the word that's in there. And whenever we would have kind of like, we were not seeing eye to eye on a topic, we could really kind of go back to our MOU and really look through that and recenter ourselves to get ourselves in a spot that we could have those tough conversations with one another. I really appreciated what Tamika said related to it's not us versus them. It's we all have the same common goal, which is educational stability for our foster youth. We may go about that in different ways, but at the end of the day, we all want the same thing for our kids. And I think that's what we continue to center on. And if anyone's ever had the opportunity to meet Shannon Boyd, she's probably one of the kindest, sweetest individuals I've ever met in my entire life. And so she and I have had some challenging conversations through the year, and she has been able to really kind of like converse with me. But a lot of those challenges have really been directly related to like those tough conversations, like finances, money, who's paying for this, right? And nobody likes to have those conversations, even in your personal life. Like nobody likes to talk about bills and who owes what to who. But that MOU really grounds us, because just like with Rowan County, we have a 50-50 split as well. That's the decision that we made in our county. So we have that too. And I recognize that I will just talk endlessly. So I'm going to pause for a minute. And I am actually, hope to not put Lizzie on the spot, but I would like for Lizzie to talk through our kind of our bid blitz meetings, because she is our POC and she does excellent with the schedule and coordinating with Shannon and Jordan.
Hi, thanks. We have moved through the years from learning experiences. I've been with the county a little over 4 years. And so when I came into this position, there was some existing MOUs and some other things, and COVID hit. And so that was fun to try and figure out with virtual school. And so our bid meetings have really evolved over the years. Initially, whenever a youth entered custody, we incorporated a bid into our transfer CFT. However, we a few years ago kind of reevaluated, wanting to look a little bit more trauma-informed at how we're supporting the families and removing as many professionals as possible from those initial meetings. And so we've pulled the bid meeting out of the transfer meeting. So if it's throughout the school year, we actually have what are called social worker ones who send that notification. So they send that over to them, so they're aware that we have a new youth in custody that's in one of their school systems. And then we work directly with the social workers who have those cases to set the bids up. A little bit of something that's unique that we do are our August Blitz meetings. So we know that any youth that is either enrolled in school this year or is entering custody over the summer or is enrolled in kindergarten is going to need a bid meeting if they become a foster care youth in that time leading into the new school year. So Shannon and Jordan and myself and our placement supervisor, Pam Clarkson, we all coordinate our schedules before the current school year ends, and we pick our days in August whenever we know everyone's going to be back. We utilize a Teams format, and we go through and notify all social workers that they have youth who have entered custody, that they need to evaluate if a bid meeting is needed. We have a sign-up sheet, and we knock out our bid meetings back-to-back for about 3 days straight in four-hour blocks. We do about 15 to 20 minutes per child. If they're siblings, we expand that a little bit. It has worked really well for us. We're able to have really good conversations with parents, with caregivers, with our social workers, when we're talking about the components of like, what is transportation going to look like? We're able to really get in with the families that are involved to identify, is this something where we're going to be able to utilize ESSA reimbursement mileage for our caregivers, or is it going to be a transport that the school system is going to pick up? Transportation has been a really fascinating evolution over the last few years. And I want to give Shannon and the Buncombe County Schools and Jordan a lot of credit for writing that out with us. We originally, when I started, had transportation through Buncombe DSS, and then we lost a lot of providers. And the school system really dug in. Shannon and Jordan both advocated deeply that now our school systems have some additional drivers who are providing opportunities for our kiddos, which has been a really amazing opportunity to ensure they remain in their school of origin if possible. Shannon or Jordan, is there anything you want to sort of share on those kind of the bid meetings or transport stuff?
Yeah, so for me, I think just having those bid meetings in August really sets us up for success for the school year. Looking at transportation, having that set from day one. So I really appreciate Lizzie for kind of navigating all of that and getting those scheduled. And one thing that Jordan and I have talked about while we were sitting here is that we both worked for DSS. So that's one thing that we have a huge respect for them. And so like Amber said, we've had some difficult conversations. I don't like confrontation or any of that, but we have had those because when it comes to finances or all that, it is definitely difficult, but I love that we're always able to come together and then come back to a solution. And so we do work very well together, and we appreciate that. And so if you don't do what they're saying, blitz meetings, bid blitz meetings, you should definitely try it because it really has been successful for me. So
I completely agree with everything Shannon has said.
So we also do have built into our MOU, and then part of like the quarterly partnership meetings is sort of the data. And I think that's been a really good conversation that we've had over the years, in that the school systems are able to share with us kind of what data they need and when they need it. We've learned that at the end of the year, there's like a big push for some pretty immediate info. And so we've been able to navigate that. And then for us, we also ask for some data related to how are our kids that are in foster care doing in school? So about mid-year, we kind of get a report on all of those pieces related to suspensions, academic success, anything that hasn't been brought to us as a need to address. Oftentimes, our school partners are part of our child and family team, so they're meeting and discussing those. But if we want to look at it at an overall level, we kind of have the opportunity to do that with the data. We do a lot of shared training, actually. The schools come in and do trainings for our staff on IEP, exceptional children's. This year, Jordan and Shannon did a really amazing training actually on McKinney-Vento, not ESSA, that really was helpful for our investigative and family in-home teams related to TSBs. We do trainings on mandated reporting. We've also been able to have conversations. DSS had a sort of a policy change this year in relation to accepting reports solely based on attendance. And so the school system had a lot of questions, and we were able to have really good conversations and kind of explain that to the social workers and the different representatives. We also internally in July, typically I do a training with our staff on the ESSA process, as well as it's kind of a lead up to the August Blitz meeting so that they understand why I'm emailing them, what these look like, what the intent is. And that's gone over really well. We make pretty much 100% of any new employee attend that, as well as anyone who might just need a refresher. And I'll turn it over to my peers if there's anything that you would like to add.
I just want to say that I'm really grateful today for the opportunity to be here and to also hear from Franklin and Rowan County, because I think as you hear from other counties, you learn about ways that you can fine tune your own processes. Like you may think you have a really great process, and I feel like we in Buncombe County have a good process, but there's things like we could always like revisit and shift when we hear some of the great things that other counties are doing. So it was really helpful for me to hear from Franklin and Rowan, to hear some of the pieces that they're doing and how they're making their partnerships work together. So I'm grateful for that and for the opportunity. LJ, Jessica, do you have any questions for Buncombe?
Question just about the establishing the MOU from both DSS side and from the LEAs. How many layers of folks in your respective agencies are involved in that process?
I don't know that any of us know the full number, if I'm being honest. What I will say with a county of our size, and I'm sure it's similar regardless of size, ultimately none of us that are participating in these meetings have the authority to sign off on those MOUs, nor do we have, we are not responsible for the invoices that go back and forth. And so those are some of the conversations I think that have needed to be navigated and at times have been a holdup with getting our MOU timely updated each year, because it has to go up through certain levels of the school system and our leadership here as well. I think that they trust us all to sort of work through what that scope of work looks like. But, you know, there's always going to be questions. And when finances are involved, things might change. So if anyone else knows how many people, I would welcome the knowledge.
On our end, we definitely, our Title I director, our student services director, and then of course our finance director. So play vital parts and roles in that MOU. And so, but it's initially assigned by, typically by our finance director. In the past, it was our Title I, but we've kind of shifted more towards our finance because we are doing more of that invoicing for transportation. We're providing county cars for some of our foster care students. And then we have drivers who maybe are teacher assistants or, you know, have another role in the school. So we have been providing those. Never thought I would be doing any kind of finance piece, but I think we have it worked out. So it's kind of, yeah, I'm not going to say anything else because I don't want to jinx it, but I think we really have it worked out and getting those in a timely manner. And so it's really made a difference. So with making sure our kids are able to stay in their school of origin. So, yeah.
Thank you for that. And I bet if I asked Rowan County and Franklin County, you'd let me know too that it's not you all here who are the end all be all of the MOUs. But you all get the process started, right? And then take it through the appropriate channels. I just wanted to draw everyone's attention to then the layers of communication and collaboration that go on up through the agencies. And then it sounds like at least in Buncombe County, connect at some level that we're not quite sure what that level is, but it's working, right? Buncombe County, any final words of wisdom for us? Thank you all so much, Buncombe County, Rowan, and Franklin. Thank you guys again for your leadership, for your willingness to share, for your honesty this morning that it's not all rosy. There are bumps and bruises along the way, but with commitment and collaboration and trust, and Tamika, yes, with connection, we make progress together on behalf of our children. Jessica, I'm going to turn it over to you to wrap us up.
Thank you. Thank you, LJ. And again, just thank you to all of our presenters from each of our counties. So this is the correct link, you all. I know there was a hiccup earlier in the call, but the webinar today, again, is being recorded and will be posted on this link. I will also work for our DSS folks to probably share some communication either through a Dear County Director's letter or the blueprint to notify you when that is posted. Again, as a reminder, you can find these slides as a handout that you can download. And I noticed there are a lot of really great questions from you all. And so LJ and I are gonna work in collaboration to develop an FAQ document that we will be able to share on this website where the recording is, as well as through communication to all of our local teams. So we just want to make sure that we capture all those questions that you provided and that we're collaborating at the state level to give you the best answer that we can. So you have heard a ton of information today. Hopefully some of this has been helpful. And just want to encourage you, if there are any questions that you think of after today's call, these are our contact information for LJ and myself. And we really encourage you to reach out. Both of us are the point of contacts for ESSA at our respective agencies. And so we want to make sure that we are able to provide the support that we can to you all. Hopefully you heard some really great things from each of the three counties. Again, just want to echo all the appreciation to each of you all. You all are on the ground doing the work, and supporting this webinar was really important to LJ and I so that other counties are hearing from those that are doing the work on the ground. LJ, any final words?
I just want to thank all of our participants today too, everyone that's been on the call. At one point, if I saw it correctly, we're up to 330 people across the state. And anytime we got that many people dedicating time and energy and focus to our students in foster care, students are going to win. And so I'm just grateful to all of you who chose to be here this morning to spend this time with us. This is the first of many other collaborative endeavors that you will see Jessica and I model for our state. So Jessica, thank you to you for being such a pleasure to work with.
Thank you, LJ. Appreciate your commitment to this work. And just want to bring us to our last slide. I forgot about this slide, but as you all save this document, just want to point out that there are some resources on here. Some of this we address throughout the presentation today, but they'll have more information for you should you need that. Thank you again, everyone, for coming, and just appreciate you taking the time out today. Take care.